Europe, 1300s. Venice, Italy, was one of the foremost cities in the Italian Renaissance. It held 150,000 people. Hundreds of canals served as roads and highways, but they also served a double purpose.
Venice had a very large and powerful navy. It had control of the Adriatic Sea. The navy maintained hundreds of merchant ships, warships, and it had thousands of sailors. Venice was almost impossible to attack because of its navy.
The Doge was the supreme leader elected for life, and he ruled the city as a republic. But citizens had very little political freedom and were at the mercy of the government. The Senate and the Great Council passed all laws. The Doge and the council members were all from wealthy families.
Florence, Italy was a city of inland trading. The basis of commercial and regulated trade were in the 12 artist guilds that occupied the city. Built in 1299, the Palazzo Vecchio was the home of the guild. Consisting of 5,000 members, it functioned as the seat of government and was the heart of Florence culture. These members included textile workers, bankers, masons, builders, sculptors, lawyers, and solicitors. They had the power to vote on laws and discuss and determine city issues. Because it wasn't a port city, sea trading wasn't a primary source of wealth. Internal banking proved to be very successful.
Born outside Florence on April 15, 1452, Leonardo grew up and lived during the height of the Italian Renaissance. He was raised in the North Apennine Mountains, a place that would change his life forever.
Leonardo's parents weren't married, so he wasn't allowed to attend the academies or artist guilds like many of his contemporaries. As a young boy, he had an immense interest in the natural world from his seemingly endless study of nature. He created a body of knowledge unmatched by anyone at the time, including the academy.
His first official painting was a Medusa on a wooden shield. It was so frightening that his father said he must have been looking at real snakes. This was the beginning of Leonardo's lifelong career, known for his careful and exact depictions of whatever he laid his eyes on. At a time when most credible artists were painting religious scenes, Da Vinci created art of a different category.
As a teenager, he earned an apprenticeship with one of the most renowned artists of the time, Andrea del Verrocchio. Their most notable collaboration was the Annunciation. Verrocchio painted most of the picture, and Leonardo finished it by painting the angel Gabriel. In 1989, experts examined the painting by subjecting it to x-rays. When they did, the angel disappeared. This was because Leonardo used a non-lead-based paint when working on it.
In 1476, just as Da Vinci was coming into prominence, he disappeared. No one knew where he was, what he was doing, who he was working with, or even what city he lived in. Leonardo literally vanished from history. When he returned to Florence in 1478, his creative output had reached an entirely new level. He went beyond art into many other subjects, and he towered above his contemporaries like Shakespeare, Michelangelo, and Copernicus.
Leonardo produced aerial maps of Italian cities with stunning accuracy. He invented machines centuries before their time. He drew out designs for modern helicopters, airplanes, submarines, tanks, scuba gear, and other weapons that we use today.
Many of the devices that he thought up couldn't be made during his time because we didn't have the technology so they could be developed. If we had developed his various concepts and ideas and his scientific discoveries, we could have possibly landed someone on the moon in the 1800s. However, Leonardo was able to design and create the world's first functioning robot. In 1517, 65-year-old Leonardo da Vinci gave King Francis I a full-size mechanical lion. It walked by its own power, independent of anything else. It wasn't replicated for another 300 years. He also came up with the first tank design with a 360-degree aim,
it wouldn't be replicated until World War I. His modern-day scuba gear and air compressor would allow you to breathe in fresh air instead of what you breathed out. This design was proven to work when recreated by the British. Also, the first attempt of a vertical flight was thanks to Leonardo's design featuring a resemblance of a modern-day helicopter. The Wright brothers took to air 400 years later.
Although Leonardo wrote down all of his inventions, ideas, concepts, and observations, he very rarely wrote anything about himself.
He was very private. There was almost no personal record of Leonardo da Vinci. But in all his papers and notes, there was one personal anecdote that talked about this cave. The note was written in 1480 after his disappearance from history. He described the cave as being absolutely terrifying, but at the same time, he had a desire to see what was inside. Some think that this incident happened at the same time as when he made the shield with Medusa's image on it. We can assume that this was a very significant event in his life because it made a strong enough impression on him to write it down.
After Leonardo's two-year disappearance, his creative output increased, but he also started to draw some very strange-looking creatures. The grotesque heads were very far off from the natural appearance of the human face, even in its most extreme form. They consisted of misshapen and flattened faces, elongated skulls, and other monstrous images.
Leonardo da Vinci was an artist known for careful, realistic depiction of what he saw. Saying this raises the question, what the heck was he looking at? Did he really see those things? Did he really see things that look like that in the cave he disappeared in?
In 1513, Leonardo da Vinci was brought from Milan to the Vatican to paint. Instead, he did something that was punishable by death at the time.
Leonardo was dissecting human remains under the Pope's feet. The catacombs beneath the Vatican had perfect conditions for dissecting corpses. You wouldn't lose anything to decomposition.
In his 36 months at the Vatican, Leonardo performed dozens of autopsies and documented them all with incredible detail.
He is a very interesting talent that he uses to hide his secrets. He is the most interesting writer of the Renaissance.
I don't always write backwards, but when I do, I need a mirror.
Stay confused, my friends.
In 1503, Leonardo begins work on a portrait commissioned by a wealthy silk merchant. He spent the last 16 years of his life on this painting. He died soon afterward.
During the Renaissance, there were strange things seen in the sky over Europe and Asia. Many artists of the time had started to paint these crafts in their religious paintings.
They depicted orbs, rays, discs, and falling stars with people sitting inside of them. There are two different theories. One, that these paintings might be clues as to the origin of Christianity, or two, the artists are documenting their sights of numerous flying objects in the sky.
The Baptism of Christ by Gelder shows a disc descending its rays upon Christ at his baptism. Madonna with Saint Giovino by an unknown artist shows a strange craft above the grown woman's left shoulder.
cantando en París. Él quiso estar junto de mí. Yo me sorprendí cuando dijo, gané. Amor.